our strategy of reading this text is that when one episode ends, we will notice that there is a mark. And now what goes on before this mark is an episode. And an episode is something which has several scenes. So we see here different references, but at the same time, we have a wide angle, that is the autobiography opens to the reader and it shows several things going on. So wide angle means that the entry point into the autobiography. Generally, films also use this technique. When the first shot is in wide angle, a long shot, wide, and some lot of things happening there, maybe a city, maybe, you know, night time and so many houses, light is there in the city, and then slowly and slowly, next scene, the camera enters a street and then perhaps a house and the character is shown. So this is what we notice, that first we are shown a wide, you know, where the house is, the basti, the women, the men, the pond, and social life and their economic life, family life. So a very general wide angle kind of, you know, description. And within it, we see the discrimination and caste-based arrangement of all those things. And then it enters the life of the autobiographer, okay, his early childhood, and how his schooling begins. So the role of Sevak Ram Masihi, that is the teacher who gave education without roof, without furniture. So, but his mission was very clear, that he wanted to take the alphabet to as many as people and teach them how to read and write. And that's a great thing. You see, once somebody learns alphabet of reading, writing, putting them together, making words and sentences, then a human's communication of intake as well as output increases. And that definitely has a lot of, you know, meaning in one's life. And for centuries, these people, including women and low caste people, they were all denied education. And so this chapter in a way begins with that episode. And it's interesting to see that a Masihi brings that alphabet. I mean, it's not somebody who is a Hindu, upper caste Hindu, who carries it. So we don't see an upper caste Hindu, for example, coming to the basti and teaching them alphabets. Now, when some dispute or argument arises between Masihi and his father, autobiographer's father, then he has to take his child to the school, the public education. And in the public education, they find upper caste teachers, but they have not yet been able to understand their privileges. That is, they were privileged with their own caste. And here the profession in the school was to put their privilege aside and become a teacher without carrying the baggage of the upper caste. But they carried the baggage of the upper caste. And that baggage is so burdensome that it oppresses the student who have come from the lower caste. And that experience is revealed. And that's it's a terrible experience and very traumatizing. It's very difficult to later even heal these experiences. These stories actually, you see, are the stories of suffering, and these sufferings are not the one which actually occurred because there was an earthquake or there was, you know, a storm. But these occurred in a, such a manner that were historically designed. So, how does somebody who suffers these episodes and whose psyche is in a way broken and whose mind faces social defeat almost every day for no reason, and sometimes a father resists and then it continues, at least the education continues, the suffering doesn't disappear. But we can see there are characters, for example, this Pradhan. So Pradhan's gesture is very different. Maybe he knows that the politics is changing, the world is changing. He is a Pradhan. Maybe he goes to attend meetings of these officials where he learns so many things. And then that is an era of Nehru and all, you know, new discourse in India is going on. But what happens, you know, sometimes the political and economic institutions change, but the social institutions do not. And that is a very, very, you know, recurrent story, that sometimes economic institution changes. For example, you become rich, but social institution doesn't change and you remain the conservative. And you still believe in that past structure. So you are in a new economy and a new political culture, but you carry the old, the baggage of your past or your social structure, and that is always causing trouble in the personal lives of so many people. And also later, you know, it becomes terrible for the political and for the economic institutions as well. So you see, this is what we see in this first episode, and we in a way a little bit understand the comprehend the way the story is being told. And then there are images, there are references. The last sentence, for example, of this episode, it seemed as though it wasn't a teacher who was coming toward me, but a snorting wild boar with his snout up in the air. So this image, for example, so these are little, so new, this Dalit aesthetics. So you see how this boar or a pig, wild pig, becomes a metaphor. So generally you see wild pigs snorting and all that, this imagination, this as a metaphor will not be there. But because a pig and all these things are very common in these people's lives, tribe sweepers and low caste people who breed them, who live with them. So this is, you know, you will notice that the similes, metaphors, expressions, language, imagery, all will have a leash of fresh life. And metaphors that we would not imagine that can be metaphors, but they would come here as metaphors. Yes. The next, Dandini.
At harvest time, all the people in our neighborhood would have to go to the field of the tagas to reap the crop. Cutting the sheaves of wheat in the midday sun is a very hard and painful task. The sun pours on your head. Fiery hot ground is beneath you. The roots of the cropped wheat plants prick our feet like spikes. The roots of mustard and chana dal hurt even more. The harvesting of these lentils presents an extra difficulty. The leaves are sore and stick all over the body. Even bathing does not get rid of them completely. Most of the reapers were from the untouchable caste of the Chudas or Chamars. They had clothes on their bodies in name only. There was no cushion of shoes on their feet. Their bare feet were hardly injured by the time the crop was brought in.
Yes, Asuganda. Yes, Suganda.
Sorry, sir. I just missed it. The harvesting would often lead to an argument in the fields. Most Tagas were miserly about paying wages. The reapers were helpers. Whatever they got, they took after some protest. After coming back home, they would fret, cursing the Tagas. But their protest died when confronted with hungers. Every year there would be a meeting in the neighborhood at harvest time. People swore to demand one sheaf out of 16 as wages. But all the resolution passed at the meeting evaporated in thin air the moment harvesting began. For wages, they got one sheaf for cutting 21 sheaves. One sheaf was less than a kilo of grain. Even the heaviest sheaf did not yield a kilo of wheat. That is, a day's wage wasn't worth even a kilo of wheat. After the harvesting, the grain had to be loaded on the bullock or buffalo carts and unloaded. Neither money nor grain was given for that work. Sooner or the later, all of us had to drive the bullock onto the threshing floor again without payment. In those days, we didn't have a thresher for cleaning up the wheat. The bullock would be taken round and round to break down the sheaves into straw. Then the grain would be separated from the chaff by blowing it in a winnow. It was a very long and tiring work. Work performed mostly by chamars or churas.
Yes, so here we have this mark. So this is a scene, and in this scene, what we notice is the economic aspect, which means that how these people were laborers in the, and where did they work? They worked on the land. Farm, agricultural land, and their masters would not even give them cash, wages, or it was very difficult for them to see how much they were getting. So instead of money in cash, they got in kind some material, some sheaf of wheat, etc., and they had to thresh and get the wheat out, which would not amount more than 1 kg a day. And then there were hidden, work, which was unpaid and for which no money was paid. And now the focus is into this area where how invisible relations, invisible relations of the society. So what we see here, which Ambedkar was always critical of, he would say, well, give them money. That is, he said, well, there are two things, labor and society. And he said, well, labor should not be interpreted from social structure, which means that generally caste society turns the labor's definition as if the labor is social property, which means that the labor of the low caste is the social labor, that he has to do it and this way, and then the society will decide what to do with it. Now, he said, well, we are in a 20th century and we have money, capital, rent, business. So in the environment of money, business, rent, etc., why is labor social? I mean, labor should not be social. Rather, labor should free itself from the definition of society. And then in the market, fine, I am paid 200 rupees a day for my labor. That's okay. But at least I know that I am not, that my labor is being paid, not my labor's social nature. So you see how it matters, the labor's social nature, for example, a sweeper. So the sweeper's job, why is it lowest paid in India? Because of the labor has been put in the definition of the society, that this is the task and this is he will do. So you see, this creates serious problem. No mobility, labor has been defined by society, no one else will do it, these people will do it, and these people will do nothing else. If I mean, they will only do this task. Now, all of these parameters reduce their wages, they become highly dependent on that kind of job, and then the people who define labor and its social relationship, they develop a language for these laborers, and then the psychological, social, political, economic, all the cycles actually ultimately turn the wheel. And at the end of the day, you have nothing but a total dehumanization of the model. So this is a very, very important, you know, paragraph, because it talks about the nature of labor in the modern society, which should be, labor is should be considered as somebody's business, not somebody's social dimension. Labor is not my social dimension. Labor is my business dimension. I think you're getting this point, what I'm making. Okay. Yes, next. We have Bhavna here. Hello, Bhavna. Bhavna Badula. Yes, Bhavna, please read this paragraph.
Okay, sir. Along with these field laborers, my mother also cleaned.
The baithak.
The baithak, the outer room or space that men use as their space for chatting or meeting. And the cattle sheets of 8 or 10 tegas, both Hindu and Muslims. My sister, elder, Bhabi, sister-in-law, and my two brothers, Jasbir and Janisar, help my mother in this work. My older brother, Sukhbir, work for the Tangas like a permanent servant. Every Tanga would have 10
every,
to 15.
Every Taga, Taga. Taga is, you know, the short name of Tyagi, okay, which is a caste.
Okay, sir. Every Taga would have 10 to 15 animals in his cow shed. We would have to pick up their dung and bring it to the place where, what is this? Where? Aplas or
Aplas,
cow,
You see, dung and bring it to the place where uplas or cow dung cakes. You know, upla is a cow dung cake. I mean, cow dung when dried and in a paste and a kind of round, you know, thing is made, which you must have seen in the Indian villages. So that is also known as upla. Okay? Right.
Cow dung cakes were made. We would take 5 to 6 basket of dung from every cow shed. During the winter month, it was a very painful job. The cows, buffalo, and bullocks would be
tethered
in long hallways. The floor would be covered with the dry leaves of cane or straw. The dung and the urine of animal would spread all over the floor overnight. We would change the matting after 10 and or 15 days, or sometime we would add a layer of dry leaves on top of soil one to search for during in the streaking cow shed was extremely unpleasant. Thus, the sting made one feel faint.
Yes, Sugandha.
To compensate us for all this work, we got 5 shears of grain per 2 animal. That is about 2.5 kilos of grain. Each Taga household with 10 animals gave 25 shears of grain a year, about 12 to 15 kilos. We got a leftover roti at noon every day that was specially made by mixing the flour with husk because it was of the churas. Sometimes the jutan, the half-eaten scraps, would also be put in the basket with the rotis for us. During a wedding, when the guests and the baratis would, those who had accompanied the bridegroom as member of his party were eating their meals, the chura would sit outside with huge baskets. After the bridegroom's party had eaten, the dirty patals or leaf plates were put in the chura's basket, which they took home to save the jutan that was sticking to them. The little remnants of puris, puffed bread, bits of sweetmeats, and a little bit of vegetable were enough to make them happy. They ate the jutan with a lot of relish. They denounced as gluttons the bridegroom's guest who didn't leave enough scraps on the leaf plates. Poor thing, they had never enjoyed a wedding feast, so they had licked it all up. During the marriage season, our elders narrated in thrilled voice stories of the bridegroom's party that they left several months of jutan.
Yes, Nandini.
We dried in the sun the pieces of puris that we collected from the leaf plates. We would spread a cloth on a charpai, a rope string cord to dry them. Often, I would be placed on guard duty because the drying puris attracted crows, hens, and dogs. Even a moment's lapse and the puris would vanish. Hence, one would have to sit near the cord with a stick in hand. So, should I continue?
Yes, Bhavana.
Yes, sir. We dried in the sun the piece of puris that we collected from the leaf
places. You see, these dried up puris were useful during the hard days. Is this here? No, that's right.
No.
We dried in the sun. Okay, please continue.
We would spread a cloth on a charpai, a rope string coat to dry them. Often I would be placed on guard duty because the drying puris attracted crows, hens and dogs. Even a moment's lapse and the puris would vanish. Hence, one would have to sit near the coat with a stick in hand.
These dried up puris were useful during the hard days of the rainy season. We would soak them in water and then boil them. The boiled puris were delicious with the finely ground red chili pepper and salt. Sometimes we mix them with gur to make a gruel and add this dish with great delight. When I think about all those things today, thorns begins to prick my heart. What sort of a life was that? After working hard day and night, the price of our sweat was just jutan. And yet no one had any grudges or shame or repentance. When I was a young boy, I used to go with my parents to help them out. Looking at the food of the tagas, I would wonder why we never got to eat food like that. When I think of those days today, I feel nauseated. This past year, Sukhdev Singh Tagi's son, grandson, Surinder, visited my house in connection with some interview. He had obtained my address in the village. He stayed the night with us. My wife fed him a nice meal, and while eating, he said, "Babiji, you make such delicious food. No one in our family can cook so well." His compliment made my wife happy, but I was deeply disturbed for quite some time. The incidents of childhood began knocking at my memory's door again. Suganda.
Surendra had not been born then. His aunt, that is Sukhdev Singh Tagi's daughter, was getting married. My mother used to clean their place. For 10 to 12 days before the wedding, my parents were doing all sorts of work at Sukhdev Singh Tagi's home. A daughter's wedding meant that the prestige of the whole village was at stake. Everything had to be perfect. My father went from village to collect rope string cords for the guests. The bridegroom's party was eating. My mother was sitting outside the door with her basket. I and my sister Maya, who was younger than I, sat close to my mother in the hope that we too would get a share of the sweat and the government dishes that we could smell cooking inside. When all the people had left after the feast, my mother said to Sukhdev Singh Tagi, as he was crossing the courtyard to come to the front door, "Chaudhary ji, all of your guests have eaten and gone. Please put something on a leaf plate for my children. They too have waited for this day." Sukhdev Singh pointed at the basket full of dirty leaf plates and said, "You are taking a basket full of jutan, and on the top of that you want food for your children. Don't forget your place, Churi. Pick up your basket and get going." Those words of Sukhdev Tyagi's penetrated my breast like a knife. They continued to sing me to this day. That night, the mother goddess Durga entered my mother's eyes. It was the first time that I saw my mother get so angry. She emptied the basket right there. She said to Sukhdev Singh, "Pick it up and put it inside your house. Feed it to your bridegroom's guests tomorrow morning." She guided me and my sister and felt like an arrow. Sukhdev Singh had pounced on her to hit her, but my mother had confronted him like a lioness without being afraid. After that day, Ma never went back to his door. And after this incident, she also stopped taking their jutan.
Yes. Nandini, next. Hello, Nandini.
Yes, sir.
The same Sukhdev Singh, it is here.
Sir, please, sir, wait for a second. Yes, sir. The same Sukhdev Singh came to my house one day. My wife welcomed him with open arms, treating him with the respect due a village elder. He did eat at our house, but after he left, my nephew Sanjay Kherwal, who was studying for his Bachelor of Science degree, said to me, "Chacha ji, he ate only at your own house, at our place. He did not even drink water." My oldest brother.
This is the mark here. So you see this episode, I mean, one crucial episode, and this is from where the title of this book, Autobiography Jutan, comes, and how this story from their personal life turns out to be, you know, I mean, so you see, therefore, story doesn't always have to be, you know, a kind of defamiliarization. That is, characters are defamiliarized from the environment, and then the writer tells the story. But in Dalit or in the literature that deals with the caste, and if it is written by the people who themselves suffered, then their life episodes are not defamiliarized, rather they are more familiarized. So their familiarity, now generally what happens that the social structure and the people who just don't want to look at into those things for the sake of positivity. You know, there is this kind of culture also, be positive, and which means most of the times, do not talk about the invisible tortures that have happened. You know, so under this positivity, there is a lot of, you know, suffering. I mean, you hide those sufferings and all. So you talk of the good things. So what are those good things? So this question is also there, this public morality of shutting their eyes off from the real spaces which show, or from where you can see the stories of the interpersonal relationships because of the systemic reasons like caste or gender or other kinds of those things. So here this, now I think this is very, very important episode, because it also adds, now along with this, we see the technique of the narration, foreshadowing, flashback, then you see, narration, for example, the narrative technique. So do we notice in this chapter, for example, somebody visits his home who is the son of one of the perpetrators. And he says, well, when he spoke to my wife and said food is good, I was reminded of my childhood days, and then I felt hurt. So you see, these episodes that actually broke you, or who brought fractures in your psyche, they reappear. And then even there came a day when the same person, Sukhdev Singh, with whom his mother quarreled and had said, well, and the Jutan episode occurred, the same person also visits his home and he eats there in his home. But he would not eat at his home if they would be sweepers in his village. So we see this is a very complex, design, where hide and seek, hypocrisy, and all these things are actually taking place. And they are not taking the issues upfront, which I think upper caste needs to see it through. And the sooner they see it, the better it would be for social structure, for harmony, for relationship, for mobility, and so on. Very, very interesting episode. Very powerful, I would say. Yes. So it is 1:09 already, and we have reached here. So I stop here today. I think that would be sufficient for you. And I think now you have got some idea of this text and how to enter into and how to look into it.